Thank you for listening to The Luminous Mind, episode 105.
As a homeschool parent and teacher, I could look at what would serve my child the best, and that was the criteria. Nothing else mattered.
Benjamin Franklin once said, "Do not curse the darkness, rather light a candle instead." If you're ready to set your mind on fire, then prepare yourself for The Luminous Mind with your host, Rebecca Bowman.
Today's fire starter is Stephen Horwich. Stephen has been a professional educator for over 40 years. He taught in the master's writing program for the University of Southern California and for the Los Angeles Unified School District and in private schools for over 10 years. He then gave up on traditional education and homeschooled his two children. Now, as a homeschool advocate, he has authored Connect the Thoughts, which is a comprehensive homeschool curriculum for students ages 5 through high school. He is also an Emmy Award-winning author of musicals, plays, and screenwrites with many credits. Welcome. We have Stephen Horwich with us again today. And he has been episode, I think I have memorized, 40, 60, and then we did a whole week, 73, I think, through 75 episodes. We took the whole week and talked about homeschooling. And then we actually, what's the one tomorrow? Is it 80?
There's so many.
Yeah. One that we're releasing on community schools. We're going to reiterate actually a comment on information or comments that were made on those podcasts. And then also we're going to talk about how to be a better parent advocate. So welcome.
Thank you. I think this is number 9.
Is it?
I think so. 8 or 9. I lost count a while ago.
We're going to have some fun today. The first thing that we were going to talk about, one of the comments that was made to me, and this was more of a verbal one, this wasn't written, but was one that we don't like schools or we don't think kids should go to college, kind of in that context that we didn't speak very highly of, especially artists and those types of children going to college. Do you want to kind of reiterate some of the things that we've discussed on that?
Sure, of course. Yeah, college is very expensive and very specialized. And depending on what it is that the student is planning on doing with their lives, college is a pretty bad option for most people. We were talking, you and I, before we came on today, and you quoted that cartoon you read. Could you quote it now? Because I want to use it.
Yeah, it's kind of a funny cartoon that I saw. And it was a college student moving back in. You know, a picture of him with his luggage moving back into his parents' house. And the parents are muttering under their breath, "Well, we started out with nothing." You know, kind of like thinking this kid, he wants all of these things that his parents have, which isn't true. He says, "I wish I was starting out with nothing." I mean, he's packing $100,000 worth of debt as he's walking through the door. It's kind of the cartoon.
Exactly right. And I don't know very many 22, 23, 24-year-olds who really can sustain the kind of debt that college imposes. Our government is not particularly forthcoming on supporting them in college. They were more supportive 20 years ago, 10 years ago than they are now. And I understand that the economics of the nation is very complicated and that there are reasons and excuses why the government doesn't support education on that level as well as it perhaps could or ought to. But the reality is that college is a very time-consuming, very expensive endeavor for the student or for the student's parents. Somebody is going to cough up that $100,000, $150,000, and depending on the college, $500,000. If you want to send your child to USC for 4 years, 5 years, it's going to cost that kind of money. I used to teach at USC, so I'm very familiar with how that works there. It's a very expensive proposition, and it's a very huge weight to put on a child's back, a 24-year-old, not a child, but a young man or woman's back, and say, now that you've got your degree, go out and compete with everybody else with the weight of a $200,000 debt on your shoulders. Additionally, there are not very many majors in college that are going to lead to a profitable profession anymore. And I think all of us need to kind of snap up to present time and look around and understand that college is not the promise of prosperity that it was when we were young, 40 years ago, 30 years ago, 50 years ago. It is not that thing anymore.
Well, and I think there's a big difference between a total amount of debt of like $5,000 and coming out and making $20,000 as an artist or whatever. I mean, the pay scale for a starting wage for any of those is ridiculous. And so that's a little more doable. But when you have, you know, you're making $20,000 and you've got $100,000 worth of student loans, it doesn't make sense.
No, it doesn't add up. You're going to be in debt into your 30s if you're lucky. And that means you're going to carry the first 10 years of your adulthood in severe debt trying to catch up. And the question I would ask somebody who's just absolutely determined to do that is, for heaven's sake, why? I think there are certain professions, as you and I discussed earlier, that you do need to get the degree. You have to go and you have to do it.
Certainly, a doctor, lawyer.
Yeah, a doctor, a lawyer, an engineer, a nuclear physicist. There are certain things you cannot do without that degree in your pocket. Even getting that degree, then you're entering an incredibly complicated and competitive marketplace for a doctor, for a lawyer. I know a number of lawyers who are struggling to make a living at this point. Personally, know them. I know them quite well because the marketplace is so crowded with lawyers. Even in a litigious society like ours, there's only so much work for attorneys. And I have a friend who got his law degree rather late in his life, in his, you know, late 40s. He secured his law degree. And he went to work for several law firms and he struggled for a while and now he's really struggling. And I think, you know, he spent the money, he got the degree, and he's questioning why he did it. And he's in New York State, which is probably the most litigious of all the 50 states in the union. So you would think there's plenty of work there for an attorney, and it isn't so. So you go through that process and you get your degree in these few professions where college is arguably a necessity, and then you have to get out and compete. And the longer you spend in college in terms of years, the harder it will be for you to infiltrate the marketplace because other younger talent will have already done what you want to do. Now, that is one of the big arguments for not going to college for an artist, like an actor or a writer or a composer or a musician. If you're going to go to college, you should be aware, as you and I have discussed earlier, that there will be other artists who do what you do and who are as talented as you are who will not go to college and will use those 3 or 4 or 6 years to build a career. And when you come out of college, you might be the star of your college drama department. Swell for you. But in the real world, where you make a living as an actor, you make a living in the arts in some way, shape, or form, what you will discover is the people who started earlier than you have established themselves, and they are your competition. Yeah. They're established. You're new. Nobody knows you in the business, and it's very rough to push somebody out of the way who's already getting all the jobs you thought you should add.
Well, and no amount of education can replace the networking. I mean, really, networking is so important. I mean, we hear that all the time. It's not what you know, but who you know that makes all the difference in getting a decent job. And I think you need to, I'm going to make a comment and then you can definitely respond to it. But when you're looking at colleges for your kids, you need to really look at, I mean, what they're going into, how that college helps the child network, or, you know, how they help them. Because I know there are some colleges, like my brother in particular went to Ohio State to get his engineering degree because he knew that they helped him network with businesses.
You're exactly right. That's one of the arguments in favor of college for some professions, is that when you go to college, it is an opportunity to network with other young people who are going to be in the same industry.
But it's not necessarily, sometimes the college is really good at having those connections open, like Ohio State was for my brother, but other colleges are horrific at it. It's just an academic.
Most colleges aren't interested in whether or not you ever get a job. That's not their concern, and they will openly tell you that's not their concern. Their concern, quote unquote, is education, though they're terribly poor at it as a rule, that is their concern, and they should be concerned because of the poor job they do. But it should be the end result of a college education, of a degree, that you're able to enter into a profession. And the reality is today that there aren't very many schools, upper level schools, that make sure that happens. Now, there are some. There are specialized technical training oriented schools like CalArts, which we talked about earlier, which trains artists, which was put there by Disney. The Disney company paid to put CalArts in business. They are strictly for artists, you know, mostly for people going into animation. And they pay for a lot of your tuition. And based on the work they see that you've done before, they pick you up as a student. Sometimes they'll pay your entire tuition because they want you to get through their program. And then Disney will look at employing that person. Well, that's a good system, because what it basically serves as is a tremendous internship rather than the prototypical college experience. They don't have general ed classes as a rule. They don't enforce all kinds of moronic semesters lost doing math and psychology and all this garbage that has absolutely nothing to do with the profession. So I think, you know, you have to look at what your child wants to do, and your child needs to look at what he wants to do, she wants to do. What profession are you looking at? That should dictate your path. And unless it's something that really demands a degree, you cannot go into that profession. And I personally would argue there are very few professions that that applies to. You can take the bar without a degree. You can become an attorney without a degree. You just have to do the study, just as Abraham Lincoln did. You can go get the books, do the studies. I had a friend who did this too, got through the bar without having a degree from a college. Now, can you get hired by a major law firm that way? Probably not. So you have to determine where you're going. What do you want? What is the end game? Do you want $300,000 in debt but a job with a major law firm? Or do you want almost no debt and to pass the bar and to be a working attorney and then to work your way somehow into the industry? These are different games that can be played in the same industry, and you would want to investigate the industry and see how it would best work. But the bottom line is there are many, many, many professions where going to college is a complete, utter waste of time. The other thing I've heard people argue in favor of college has been, my kid doesn't know what he wants to do, and he's going to go to college in order to experience life and a bunch of majors and minors, and college will help him determine what he wants. Well, first of all, if you don't have any idea of what you want to do by the time you're 18, then your education has completely and utterly failed you. Completely failed you. If you don't know by the time you're college age what you're interested in, then you have received absolutely no education. It's a terrible failure.
Well, and going to college and just racking up debt on, you know, stuff that you don't even know you want to do.
On a whim.
Yeah,
on a whim.
It's ridiculous.
Yeah, it is ridiculous. And parents go through this all the time. My daughter, when she was going through her teen years, got interested in many different things. You know, today she's interested in playing guitar. Tomorrow she's interested in something else. And I, being the loving single dad, you know, my wife had passed away years earlier and I was raising her alone. I got her everything she wanted. I got her a really cool guitar. And when she was studying animation, I got her an animator's desk and got her lessons. And she would do these things for a while, and I'd invest a fair amount of money, and then she'd get bored with them and want to do something else. So college is the extreme ad absurdum of that, you know, taking it to the point of the ridiculous. I'm going to send my kid to college to discover what he wants to do. Oh, man, what a horrifyingly wasteful, expensive thing to do for a kid who just is refusing to make up his mind what he's interested in, or who has not had enough experience with life. Get him experience with life, not with college. College is not life. It is insulated. It is insular. And it is not very good in terms of providing you a life experience.
Well, and we have discussed, too, I mean, if you want to explore classes of, you know, what you may think you want to do, either going to a community college or even there's so many free online classes that teach. I mean, we talked about MIT in engineering. You know, I mean, there's so many free classes that you can take. And then if you don't want to, if you really don't like that, I mean, my son did this with he took anatomy and physiology or maybe it was medical terminology, online that has spawned an interest for him, and so he's moving that direction. We didn't have to spend the money for the class to find out he didn't want to do that.
Exactly right. So, there are so many different ways for anybody to experience something. College is just one of them, and it is one of the most expensive and time-consuming.
Yeah.
There are many, many other ways for your youth to discover the world out there. And yes, of course, there are many free courses on the internet. I provide some in creative writing and some other areas myself. And I know there's almost an infinity of experience available there. But also, if you turn the computer off, you know, an 18-year-old shouldn't be living at the screen. He should be go outside and get work, perhaps, and experience different professions for a year or two. And if he really hasn't decided what he wants to do, he's really not sure where he wants to go with his life, then experience is what's called for. And apparently his education lacked in it. I don't know a lot of 18-year-olds who received a liberal education, meaning a broad education where they had a lot of experiences, rather than a conservative education that was limited to what the state required or something silly like that. I don't know a lot of kids who had that kind of education who didn't know what they wanted to do, usually by the time they're 12 or 13. They had a pretty good idea. I knew what I wanted to do when I was 5, and I'm doing it. I don't get that thing. One of two things has happened to an 18-year-old who has no idea what he wants to do. One, he's received no education at all, and two, he's incredibly lazy, and so are his parents, because nobody has done anything.
Nobody's required him to work at all.
Or experience life, even just experience life. You don't have to work at 18. That's okay. But you do have to have enough experience with life that you have a pretty fair idea of where you'd like to go. You're 18.
Yeah.
You know, so whatever.
And some of that might be our culture of being too scared to let our kids outside for whatever, you know, if the neighbors call the cops on us or something because they're out there actually playing versus somebody, some adult controlling their fun. So we've kind of discussed that. I guess my feeling is that really study and vet out what your child wants to do and how well that school helps them. And then also, you know, who their mentors are going to be, because we had discussed too that sometimes academia goes from academia back to academia. You know, there's never any professional role there. So really be sure.
That's particularly true in my experience with the arts, where people teaching writing or acting or music or whatever never actually had a professional experience in the area. They went from being a student to a teacher. You know, they became a full-time teacher, and then they ended up in a college somewhere.
Yeah.
And those people have no experience in the real world with the real industry. They don't know how to get a job. They don't know what the real industry demands of an artist, and they can't teach you what they don't know.
Yeah.
So you're wasting your time. All they can teach you to do is become a teacher or fail in the industry, because that's what they did. They either failed and became a teacher, or they never even tried and became a teacher. Either way, they can't teach you anything about the business.
Well, and sometimes they have had a career and then they're older. I mean, those are definitely a better mentor, but that's not necessarily the norm
That would be incredibly rare in academia.
Yeah.
I've taught at 5 different colleges over the years. I never met a teacher who fit that description you just made. Never. Not in the arts areas, not in acting, not in writing, not in music. None of them had careers professionally. They were all professional academics what they were.
All right. So I guess we can move on. The next comment that we had from a listener was, this listener is from California. This was in response to our podcast about, you know, getting them involved in different activities. And she's from California, and she said that she knows that in the state of California, you're not allowed to have your children in either school sports or their music program or whatever. And that she basically said that she has a high school directly behind her house. And, you know, her kids watch the kids play, and she's not able to allow them to do that because the high school is stopping her. Now, we made kind of a comment that is legal in every state for them to allow you to be part of the sports teams and the music programs. I mean, let's kind of discuss that, because
there are
pockets.
That's not actually what I said. What I said is they're obligated to accept you. They have no choice. They accepted the tax money that came from you and your family. They have to accept your student. They have no choice. In some states, the legal obligation is recognized by the Department of Education for the state. I'll give you an example, which you and I were talking about privately earlier. So my brother is starting to homeschool his son, and they're in Nevada. And he wanted to know what exactly he needed to do to get his son involved in the local school's sports program. So I went and I looked. I looked at the Nevada laws, and they're all available at the Nevada Board of Education site. It's very clearly stated. It's not hard to find. You can also go to the HSLDA, the Homeschool Legal Defense Association. HSLDA is the site on the internet. And if you look up your state, all of the regulations for your state for homeschooling are listed there, what you need to know to homeschool or to get involved in other activities that the school district is supposed to provide to all the kids who are the correct age in their district, regardless of whether they're registered in a school or not. The Nevada State Board of Education clearly recognized and acknowledges on their site that homeschoolers are allowed, yes, they are allowed to participate in all sports or arts programs in the high schools, with the one proviso that the homeschooling student must go through whatever the same audition or tryout process would be for any kid in the school. Well, that's perfectly fair. So if you're in Nevada and you're homeschooling, your kid wants to play baseball at the local high school, he goes and he tries out. And if the high school gives you any guff, you point them back to their own site, to the Board of Education for Nevada, where it states very clearly that's the law. That happens to be the law across the country. No school can prevent your child from participating. They can't do it unless for some reason your child is an axe murderer and they can prove it. They cannot prevent your child. They took your tax money, folks. What did you give it to them for? They took it and they said, quote unquote, we're going to use this for education. Well, for whose education? If your kid is in that age range and you're homeschooling, you're paying twice for your kid's education because you're paying your taxes and you're also paying to educate your kid at home. And if you want to use the local school's football program or tennis courts or baseball program or get them involved in the theater arts program, and you know what time of day your local school does that, you have every right to go to that school and demand your child's right to try out for that program. It is illegal anywhere in the state for the schools to prevent your kids from participating in what you paid for.
Well, and one of the things that we saw here in Idaho when a lot of these virtual homeschooling curriculums became available, as well as the charter movement really picked up, is that it is legal here in Idaho to use, or it is everywhere, but it is stated in the laws that any homeschooled, any child from, you know, a charter school is allowed to participate. But what we saw is that the individual district was saying, no, I'm not going to let you. And it was only when parents pushed against that they alleviated it and they didn't make it miserable. One of them wanted to charge, if you homeschooled or if you were from a charter school, they wanted to charge you $1,000 to participate, which the state of Idaho actually came back and said, no, you can't do that. You know, if
it's
you,
illegal.
Yeah,
it's
if you push
you
hard enough. Yeah.
You already paid. All right. So let's take what you just said and let's sum it up. This is simple and it gets us into the main discussion we wanted to get into. Folks, they're your children. Look at their faces while they're sleeping. When they're doing their homeschool work, sit down and talk to them and remember all the reasons why you care about them. And then put on your fighting gloves and put on your running shoes and go fight for your kids' rights. They are their rights. You have these rights. The schools cannot charge you for them. They can't do anything. They can't do anything to your kid because he's homeschooling that they don't do to other kids in the school who are attending the school. So unless they're charging $1,000 for a kid at the school to participate in a given program, they can't charge your kid $1,000 for that program. They're not allowed to because they took your tax money. So,
I mean, it really does come down to the fact a lot of these school districts or states haven't been challenged.
Right. Well, that's what I'm talking about now. That's why you got to put on your gloves, folks. You're fighting for your kids' futures. And if you have a kid who really, he's a terrific baseball player, he's 14 years old, he's a terrific baseball player, and the best program in your area isn't Little League, it's high school, which or junior high, which would be surprising to me, frankly, because usually these things are done better outside of school districts. But let's say you're in a place where the best option is the local school, and they tell you no, they are operating illegally. And at that point, what you do is you make a bunch of noise, you bypass the school, write to the Board of Education for the school in adamant terms and get other parents involved too. And if that doesn't work, then I'm afraid you hire an attorney or you go to the HSLDA, you file your complaint, you get an attorney involved, you file against the state, and probably win a bunch of money from the state because they're behaving illegally. And that's the key. You don't just lie down and go, oh, the school district won't let us do what we want to do because we're homeschoolers. You have rights. And they're the ones operating outside of the law, not the homeschooler. And at that point, you must stand up and insist on your children's rights. Yeah. You have to do it.
All right. So I was discussing with my sister, and I think I had her on as episode number 2, and she actually went the gamut of public school, the charter school, and now she's homeschooling. And she has mentioned, you know, she's moved to Texas and, you know, their school district hasn't allowed them to do that, or the state or whatever. And most of her friends are very glad that they haven't, because they've built really strong private organizations of baseball or football or music orchestras or things like that, that are just strictly with homeschoolers. But I mean, her response to me was she knew that if she pushed it like we did in the with the charter movement or the homeschooling movement here in Idaho, that they would bend. It's just she's ran out of fight. You know, I mean, she just doesn't want to fight anymore.
Yeah, it's hard to do on your own. And I do believe that, you know, one of the things to remember when you find yourself in that kind of a position is that you're not alone. First of all, you're one of millions of homeschoolers in the United States, depending on whose numbers you want to believe. Now, I think the Department of Ed admits that there are almost 2 million homeschoolers, or around 2 million homeschoolers in the United States. That's a lie. There's closer to 6 million and probably more by now. So, you know, you're far from alone, and there are a lot of people who will fight at your side if you make your case known. But you can't give up, because what you're dealing with when you deal with a school district pulling that kind of a stunt is some petty, small-minded, moronic bureaucrat who has just a little tiny corner of power. Oh, the smallest ant-sized, you know, particle of power, and has blown it up in their mind to something monstrous where they can tell your kids what to do. And they don't have that right. They never had that right. They never will have that right. And just because they stand on top of the school building and shout it at the top of their voices does not give them that right. Eric Holder, who was attorney general and now I think is hopefully, you know, digging trash cans out somewhere because he's a terrible human being. What he did was he made a speech a few months ago, which you and I have discussed briefly, and he said the government has the right to remove homeschooling. It isn't a right. We can take it away at any time. That's a lie. He was wrong. He's a small-minded bureaucrat who went power mad and thought he could make a statement like that, which contravenes existing law. He's dead wrong. I wish he had tried. It would have been a beautiful thing to see him completely emasculated. So I got to tell you, folks, you're not alone. I understand it's tough to, you know, confront a school district or administrators who will stare you in the face and say, we're right, you're wrong. But they're not right. They're operating outside the law. Take it from another route. If somebody had sideswiped your car while you were parked and your car's not in motion, they swipe, and then you pulled them aside and you said, you just hit my car. And they said, no, you hit my car. And I'm going to yell that really loud until the world believes me. And I'm going to sue you for the damage to my car. You would get mad enough to fight back. I know you would, folks. I know you would. And this is your children, way more important than your car. We're talking about your kids and their futures and their rights. And there's another reason to fight, and that is that your kids will see it. They will see you fighting for their rights. They will understand that it's a good thing to fight for your rights. They will understand that you love them to the point where you'll put yourself on the line in that way. These are wonderful, valuable experiences for kids as well. You need to do it.
Yeah. Well, and we are advocates for starting private groups, too. And I know a lot of homeschoolers, they just don't want anything to do with the government because, like we've discussed, that they find them inept. And so,
put me on that list.
Yeah. I mean, we're talking about in cases, and definitely, I mean, push it to what you want, but in cases, too, where there's really no other, you know, options as far as activities for your kids, you know, to really stand up and be an advocate.
I think, you know, at the end of the day, it's a funny thing. I would actually advise different people in different ways regarding this kind of thing. Normally, I advise people to take the line of least resistance. Look around, find a great homeschool sports program or a great private sports program because they're everywhere. Parks and Rec has programs your kid can play baseball and football in that are usually at least as competitive as most schools. There are all kinds of ways to do this and involve your kid there. And that's one approach to this problem.
Well, and this caller's or this listener's son was high school age. I've even seen here in Idaho where YMCA or whatever, I mean, if he can get, you know, a group of his buddies that can't get on the basketball team in the local high school, they can definitely start their own team. It's probably a little more limited than what he would have as far as high school stuff goes. But
well, yes and no. I think that's a great observation. When I was in my early teens, I had been acting and I had started writing and directing at that point. I formed my own theater company when I was 14 years old. We started doing full musical theater productions when I was 15 to raise money for local charities. We were supported by other local charities like the Kiwanis Club, who came in and financially supported our first few projects. And, you know, we were a bunch of kids doing something we were told kids can't do. I went to my high school's vice principal. It was a woman. But I went and I sat down with her when I started this theater arts company that was, you know, all my friends and I got them together. And I think we did 20 plays over the next 5 years and told her what I was going to do. And she looked me across her desk and she said, "Students can't direct their own activities." Never forgot it. And I smiled at her and I said, "Well, thank you for that input." And when our first show opened, I left two tickets on her desk. You know, here, come as my guest. I want to show you what students can do on their own.
Before we go on, let us take a minute to hear about our sponsors. Homeschooling but need help covering all the important subjects? Want to make sure you're thoroughly covering science, history, civics? Trying to get arts and language skills into your student homeschooling? How about creative writing? The answer is Connect the Thoughts, a proven secular curriculum for ages 5 through high school. For over 10 years, Connect the Thoughts has improved educational results for over 20,000 homeschoolers. Hundreds of parents, student success stories tell the tale. Connect the Thoughts, the best homeschooling curriculum available. Use the link at theluminousmind.net podcast show notes page and download free samples today. Welcome back to The Luminous Mind, where we have the privilege to be mentored by Stephen Horwich.
So you can always start your own activity, but there are two answers to that question. Use the line of least resistance, find an organization that doesn't require anything of you than to show up and participate, like, you know, Little League or Pop Warner football or whatever. And the second answer, depending on where you are and what your situation is, fight. Fight for your rights. If the school is the best option and you want that for your kid, man, you better get ready to fight because you'll need to do it. Tim Tebow's in the NFL was a homeschooler, and he went through, in my understanding, very similar things to what you and I are talking about now, where he wasn't allowed to play football for the schools. I believe his parents insisted that he be allowed to, and he went through that, and then he went to college, and he became one of the top-rated athletes in the United States and went in the NFL. So it can be done, folks, but you have to, you know, sometimes – You have to go toe-to-toe, nose-to-nose, and know that you're right, and within the law, they are not.
Yeah. Well, I like the idea of you going through the Kiwanis Club, too. I mean, we are living in a day and age now when homeschooling is becoming very popular, and a lot of people see it as a great option. Some of these groups are, and so, yeah, I go through that. That's great. Well, one of the other things that I did want to talk to you about, this is going to be kind of a conglomerate of a lot of different topics, but where you came from. I mean, we haven't really discussed how your paradigm as an educator changed over time and with experience. That's kind of my tagline of, you know, changing the paradigm of education. I'm just curious, you know, as an educator, how you came to be such a strong homeschool advocate.
Well, I'll give you my thumbnail history as an educator. I started out as an educator very young. You know, I think like a lot of kids who do pretty well academically, I was asked to assist kids who were not doing well academically, and I started doing that when I was about 8 or 9.
Wow.
So I got used to teaching very early on. I had some good teachers in public schools, particularly in elementary school. I had two very, very nice teachers, got me very interested in music and in academics and writing.
So you don't hate teachers. I mean,
I don't hate teachers. I hate bad teachers, and I hate school systems, and I hate standards and national standards and Common Core and tests and grades and grade levels and classrooms and all of the tools of modern education as they're applied institutionally. That's what I hate. Teachers, there are some terrible teachers and horrible people who teach, and I really despise them and hope they go away really soon. There aren't very many good teachers, and the good ones, I really question their ethics at this time because they make the rest of the system almost look like it works because of what they do, the few good ones. Hey, I had a good experience in school because I had two great teachers. Well, that's not a good experience in school. That's a good experience with two teachers. And they probably should be outside of the districts teaching independently and not contributing to the illusion that modern education as it's delivered institutionally works, because it doesn't. So moving on, I started that, and then I was very successful in junior high and high school in theater arts and music. I won a bunch of statewide awards and competitions, and I earned a lot of respect from other students and other schools around the state. I'm in California because of the work I did at that time running my own theater program and directing the shows, some of the shows at our high school and that kind of thing. So I started teaching theater arts and music in private workshops when I was 16. The first one I invited students from around the state, I think I had about 80 students show up for my first round of workshops that I taught to actors when I was 16 years old. So I started young. I started really young. I did not go to college because I was working professionally. I had an Emmy Award when I was 17 as a writer and a director and an actor, and I was already working professionally. In my early 20s, I had a friend who was teaching in the professional writers program at USC. He himself was an academic, not a writer. And they really desperately needed a professional writer to help teach the program. He knew my work. He had known me for a while. And he asked if I would come in and co-teach that program with him and another guy who did have some professional experience and also was an academic. So the three of us taught that program together. I was there for about a year and a half at USC helping teach the professional writers program.
Well, and I have had a number of guests on that have been part of that program where they bring, you know, writers in the school or they bring photographers or artists that teach the classes, and none of them are academics. They're all people who have been very successful outside in the business world and wonderful artists that come in and help.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so, amen. I mean, amen and hallelujah, right?
Basically a second to what you were doing, right?
Yeah, I considered it a privilege to teach at USC when I was 22 years old. It was a privilege. You know, I was basically teaching other kids my age who did not have my experience or my success yet. And it was a privilege to get to do that. I enjoyed it. After that, my two best friends in the world, both of whom have passed away now, you know, were both college professors. I met them through a friend of mine in high school who was their kid, and I got to know his parents you know, and got much closer to them than I'm afraid I ever got to anybody my age. They were wonderful people. They took me in when I was financially struggling in my early 20s, and they were wonderful teachers. Her name was Estelle Litt, and Estelle taught other teachers how to teach on the university level. And Mark, her husband, was an economics professor who ran 11 economics departments simultaneously at one point, I believe, and who also created the idea of the portable pension and got it to his local senator, who then got it through the Senate, and it became the law of the land, so that when you quit a job, your pension moves with you to your next job, and you don't just lose that money. That was Mark's idea. So he's a wonderful man, and both of them were tremendous teachers and spectacular human beings who showed me that it is possible to be a very good person and be a teacher, of course, right?
Yeah.
And got me far more interested in teaching, and they asked me if I would do more teaching, and I kind of reluctantly agreed. So they got me a position working with LAUSD, Los Angeles Unified School District, in a high school. It was a magnet school, which means they were pulling students in from all over the county. And I was there supposedly to assist a teacher, but I ended up teaching six classes a day unassisted. So I was a teacher for a year, and I found it to be the most excruciating experience as an educator and as a human being imaginable. One of the things I noted while I was there was that many of the teachers in private would express absolute disdain for their students. They hated teaching and they hated their students. And whenever a teacher tells me that's impossible, teachers love their students, I was there. I saw it. I lived with it. And I've known teachers since then who hated their students. And some teachers have come out and talked on the internet about how much they hate their students. I'm sorry, folks. A lot of teachers do not like your kid. And why is that? Because they're bad human beings and bad teachers. And they never accept the responsibility of being a teacher. It's always over to the parents and the kid to do all the work, and the teacher is there for the ride in their minds. I saw a lot of that. I saw many, many teachers who hated their students. And that made me crazy. I absolutely despised that school.
To kind of talk about, I mean, in that system, kind of what we talked about with our community, our podcast on building a community, I think a lot of that, I think if they were teachers and they actually had to be trying to make their own money, where this is just money that comes from the state and they don't really have to work for it, I think that kind of creates that.
Yep. And in spite of what you hear, folks, about teachers being overworked and underpaid, that's just another lie sponsored by teachers' unions and Bobby Weingarten and all those horrible people that are running your school systems, essentially. Teachers are very well paid for the amount of time they put in. They're only really required in most districts to put in about 6 hours a day, 5 days a week for 9 months. So when they complain, as they did in Chicago, that now they're only making $80,000 a year for a beginner teacher for 9 months for 6 hours a day, 5 days a week, I'd like you to compare that to your own pay and take a step back and consider whether or not they're not severely overpaid, given that half their students drop out before they ever graduate.
I know teachers in Idaho aren't paid that well, but there aren't a lot of professions that really are in Idaho. So
yeah, right.
Just comparably, they're doing fine.
Yeah, it's comparable. Teachers are usually somewhere near the top of professional pay scales or in the middle, you know. The problem I have with that is that their results are so much poorer as a group than other professions. I don't understand why we're obligated to pay them that kind of money. Let them get a result. Let them get paid by result. That's the argument behind teaching to a test. Let's see how the students do, and we'll give a teacher a bonus based on how well the teachers do. And that's not what I'm advocating for. I hate that. I hate tests. I hate state standards and federal standards. I hate the idea of giving a teacher a bonus because they actually did something. You know, there's all kinds of problems with that argument. That was started in Washington, D.C. by Michelle Rhee, who was the head of that school district, the idea of giving teachers bonuses for performance if their kids did well in tests. And it's one of the worst ideas of all time. In any case, I did that teaching for LAUSD for 1 year. One of the things I remembered happened while I was there that turned me off to institutional teaching was they would have a in-service every couple weeks where the teachers would meet and an expert would be brought in and talk about education, which would be paid for, of course, by the school district. And I attended my first in-service, and it was some psychologist spouting absolute drivel who had clearly never educated anyone in their lives and never sat down with a child and didn't know what a child looked like and would probably be terrified to find one in their space. And when this person finished, they asked for questions, and I put up my hand and I asked, what did you get paid for doing this in-service? And she said $200, which, by the way, 40 years ago is a fair amount of money for an hour talk. And I smiled. I said, then I have some advice. Can you please, next time, not spend the money on an in-service? Give it to me, since this school does not have a library, and I will go and buy $200 worth of books so that I can teach English electives in this school, which you are all asking me to do, without books. But they were willing to have the in-service and spend the money. They didn't care about kids. The kids were not the priority. The teachers were the priority. They always are. Teacher unions are not called kid unions. They're called teacher unions, and they only protect the rights and the privileges and the pay and the perks of teachers. Kids are not represented in the system. They have no rights. And only a parent standing up on his 2 feet will guarantee that his kid receives anything that should be coming his way.
That's exactly right. So, and then how did you move into being such a strong homeschool advocate?
So I had kids when I turned 30. My daughter was born, and 4 years later, my son was born. I'm 59 now, so you guys can do the math. I am actually 32 years old now. That's how that math works for those of you who aren't very good at math. Anyway, I had kids, and I was determined never to send them to public school, and I never did. So immediately they started attending private schools as they got old enough to go to school. And I taught in all of the private schools they attended. I created arts programs in theater and music and arts and other areas of the arts, and ran those programs each time they went to a school. So I taught in private schools for, 12, 13 years. Then my daughter came home on her first day of quote unquote high school with her first history assignment. And she went to a nice private school. I was very happy to teach theater arts there. We had a very active theater program, and the kids were coming out of that school and going directly into the business of acting and writing, exactly as I've described, because I'm a professional and that's how I taught it. But the academics were not very good in this private school, as they are very often not very good in private schools. They're a little better than public schools, but they're not very good. And she came home with her first history assignment on her first day of school in high school, and it was one page with about 100 words written on it and a really silly pencil drawing, which supposedly was the entire history of Egypt. My jaw dropped. I was on the board of the school. I'd been complaining about the academics for 3 years, adamantly, every meeting, complaining about the math and the history and the science and how poorly they were being done. And I looked at that and I realized, wow, I can't complain anymore. Now I have to do something, because this is never going to change. And if I don't take a stand with my kids and take their education in my hands, I will have two young adults on my hands with no education, no abilities.
Well, especially when you're paying for it like that, too.
I was putting in my time to pay for it. If I'd been paying financially, money, paying for tuition, it would have been about $2,000 a month. I was putting in $2,000 a month of my time to run the programs. I was actually doing more than that because I wanted all the kids there to do well. And in the arts areas, they did very well, but in the academic areas, not so much. So I sent a note to the school the next day with my daughter, second day of school, saying, you are not to give my daughter any of your history, science, or math curriculum. When you get a curriculum that works, you may give her that. In the meantime, she's only going to work on arts and in other areas at the school. And I got a call 10 minutes after she arrived at school saying, come pick us up, after I'd been teaching at the school for 9 years. I love the principal. She's a wonderful lady, terrific, and loved the kids. But there just wasn't a rigorous, we're going to get these kids educated viewpoint. They just didn't have it. I had it. They didn't have it. So I pulled my kids out, and that day I started homeschooling. And I looked at curriculum that was available on the internet at that time, which is about, 11 years ago now. My daughter's 27. So yeah, about that, something around that. And there wasn't anything that I was happy with, nothing. It was all very, in my case, I was looking for a secular curriculum, and there wasn't any. Most homeschoolers 10 years ago were mostly homeschooling for religious reasons, so there wasn't a big demand for secular homeschool curriculum. And I think that's very much changing now. And I'm glad to see that it's changing, because people should homeschool for a vast variety of reasons, one of which being that the schools will not educate their kids. So I started writing curriculum that day. I started homeschooling that day. I filed with an organization in Florida that handled the paperwork so that we were legally homeschooling. But the next year, I didn't, because I decided the government didn't need to have any idea or knowledge of what I was doing with my children educationally. It was none of their business. I was paying taxes. I was supporting the school district, but I can educate my kids the way I see fit, and it's not the government's place to tell me how. So I stopped registering my children and never did register them again after that. Was that legal? No. Was it smart? No. Did I do it? Yes. And I did it because I was strictly interested in my kids' well-being, and I was no longer interested in playing the social game or the societal game of the rules as the government establishes for education, having clearly seen how ruinous, how disastrous those are. So from that point, I started homeschooling and writing the curriculum. I worked 15 hours a day on curriculum. I had 10 kids in my house homeschooling. By the fourth week we were homeschooling, we had three other families all together. So I had 10 kids in my house every day. Two of the parents were trained teachers. They delivered my curriculum to the kids. They made sure the work got done while I kept writing courses and rewriting courses, because the kids were right there in the next room and I could fix things right away when something didn't quite work. And we did that for numerous years. Over that span of time, I figured out how to homeschool. You know, I was already a long-term educator. I'd spent, you know, decades teaching in private schools and public school and in universities, and I started very young. So I knew how to educate, but homeschooling has specific needs, and it's a good idea to be open to those and see what they are and adjust. So I found that homeschooling was far more flexible than any other form of education, that I could focus the child's education on his interests. I didn't need to do the quote-unquote required subjects every day, because a kid may not like math, and force-feeding him math every day was like force-feeding him cod liver oil. But he loves some other subject, and if I just let him concentrate on that for a couple of months, he loved his education, he loved his homeschooling, and he loved getting smarter, and that should have been the goal all along. So the flexibility vastly appealed to me. I started realizing that I could schedule homeschooling differently than school, different times of the year, different times of the day. I could schedule different subjects in different ways. I had the freedom to take the kids out of the house and do other things with them that would be educative. There were many, 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 many freedoms that simply do not exist, and restrictions that do not exist within institutional education. We didn't have a theater to work with. We didn't have a football field. You know, we didn't have enough students to worry about those kinds of things. But I found ways for them to do theater arts. My son became a professional actor in spite of everything. My daughter is now a professional writer. So somehow or other, I was able to communicate the arts to these kids. Several of the others who homeschooled with me now, I know two of them are producers of film at this point. So, you know, somehow or other, we managed to create an arts program that worked for those 10 kids. I think what persuaded me that homeschooling is the answer is so various. There's so many reasons. But a lot of it was, in my mind, when I drew a comparison between what it was like for kids and teachers in an institution, even a good private school, a fairly free private school, and homeschooling, your ability to service the individual child is so much greater as a homeschooler. Your freedom to focus their education on what they want to do and where they want to go is so entirely greater as a homeschooler than in the freest of institutions. There really is very little comparison to the quality of the experience for the child. And as a teacher, the institutions come with strings attached. As a teacher, endless strings attached. You have to abide by whatever the rules of the institution is. Even private schools have their rules and regulations and their systems, and you have to live and die by them. As a homeschool parent and teacher, I could look at what would serve my child the best, and that was the criteria. Nothing else mattered.
Well, and I think when you give the child an opportunity to fill his head with what he wants to fill it with, they do become well-rounded. I think that's when people listen to homeschoolers say, well, we just want the kids working on the things that they want to work on. I have seen very few homeschool kids that don't have some sort of well-rounded education of some sort, you know, where
apparently according to state tests and all that kind of stuff and the federal tests that are issued when you finish high school, homeschoolers have a far better well-rounded education because they score better in all the different areas as a rule than institutionally educated children. They do better in math, they do better in English skills, they do better. All the testing indicates that homeschooling provides a more rounded, complete education, which is another thing I observed and went and got the numbers and looked at all the statistics. In the end, in spite of what everybody thinks or says, which is completely irrelevant, in the end, what the numbers tell us is that homeschoolers are better educated. And I've since discovered that many universities, for those of you who are determined to send your children to universities, many major universities now, like Harvard and Yale, are actively promoting for homeschoolers. Those are the students they want. They would prefer them over institutionally educated children because they're better educated and, here's the joke, better socialized. You know, the whole socialization thing, they actually deal with others better than kids who have spent years in schools being terrified about being brutalized in some way, shape, or form and failing tests and getting bad report cards and being sexually abused by their teachers. You know, they're safer, they're more secure, they're more stable, and deal with others at a higher level than kids who go to school as a rule. There are exceptions, as a rule.
Yeah. So how do you feel like homeschooling changed you? I mean, as the parent going through this.
I had always taken that kind of responsibility for my kids from the beginning. That's why I was teaching in their schools. From the first day they went to school, I was in their school every day. I was teaching and running arts programs. So I made it go right to do that and continue my professional career as a writer and director because that's how important my children are and were to me. So that I can't honestly say that homeschooling per se changed me as a parent because I was already there. It didn't need to change me. I was already profoundly involved in my kids' lives and their education. But I would say as an educator, it changed me. And I think that's really more to the point for me. It changed my mind about what education is, what it should be, how it works best. And I went into it with the idea that all I was going to use, all that I was going to be interested in was what worked, what demonstrably improved the child's life, what made his life better. Nothing else was going to be retained. And as I took that viewpoint as an educator, I changed. I looked at grades and grade levels and classrooms and all that stuff. And I realized over the next 4 or 5 years, these things don't work. The most important thing that I looked at that changed for me is a bigger generic thing. It's that the critical approach to education, I realized, did not work, that there was a better way, and it involved admiring the student's work. Admiration worked better than critique. Critique in education takes the form of testing, grading, sitting down with the student and his parents and saying, Johnny's doing badly in math. Now he's going to have 2 hours of homework. Homework is a form of critique. It says that the child didn't finish his work during the regular school hours, which is, of course, a lie, because the people who really didn't finish their work were the teachers who should have been able to educate that child in the 5 or 6 hours that they had him in prison. Oh, I mean in school, excuse me. So they didn't do their job, and now Johnny has homework, and you know, it's another form of critique. Hey, Johnny, you were too stupid to finish your math in school. Here's your homework. And mom and dad, your lives are over because you're going to help them with the math 2 hours a night for the rest of your life. This approach to education very quickly started to lose all of its savor for me as I moved out of schools and into homeschooling. And I realized this absolutely was the core problem in education. The idea that critique makes for good education. Critique makes for very scared children. It does not make for a good education. Admiration builds up the child, builds up his interest in his own work and his own output because he knows it's admired. So why wouldn't he do more? There are all kinds of reasons why it works better. The bottom line, what I realized and what changed me as an educator was I realized that I could toss out all the critique-oriented techniques and just rely on admiration. As I've gotten better and better at that over the years, I've gotten to be a better educator. I wish I'd had this realization before I ever started my own children's education. It came too late in the chain for it to make a tremendous dent in their education, but I'm making sure that it is being applied now in what I do for other kids. And, you know, at the end, towards the end, of course, the last 4 or 5 years of their education, I was able to increasingly apply that approach. So.
Well, and I think it's interesting how instinctively all of us that have went through the system, we see the flaws, you know, we see how critique still stunts our ability to grow now. There's still some of that in there. But even though we may see the downsides, how the way we were educated and the techniques that were used, somehow we still think that that's necessary in order to have a good education. I think it does take kind of opening your mind to other possibilities.
You know, I think you're right, but I think there's two reasons for that. One is that it's systemically still being done. We see it all around us. You know, employers critique employees. The law critiques every individual who comes before a judge. Schools continue to critique every child and every teacher's activity. We see it as the system. And I think that leads to the second thing. We don't see the options. They're not presented. We're not presented with other ways to live life that exclude critique as the criteria. Without knowing there are other options, like, hey, I don't have to be critical of Johnny. Instead, I can admire his work, select out of it what I find admirable, and then let him know I find it admirable, instead of selecting out of his work what I find critiquable and critiquing it. You know, I'm asking parents, I'm asking teachers to go the opposite direction from what they've been trained to do and what they've been told works, when a patent statistically has proven to fail utterly. But we're not told there are other ways. Well, there is this other way, and there are people who employ it, and there are people who promote it, of coming in and admiring a student's work. You're going to get a better result out of a kid who wants to study and who's loving what he's doing. And if you browbeat him and critique his work to death, you won't get that result. And that is, for me, the bottom line. What works? That's all I care about. What works? What works is admiration. What does not work is critique.
Wow. Well, I could ask you a dozen more questions, but with the length of our conversation, I think we're running out of time. But maybe if I can think of other questions that I have for you. I just want people to understand that you're a nice guy.
I'm not a nice guy. You know, it's funny you say that. I'm a nice guy to people who are nice to children. I'm not a nice guy to people who are not nice to children. I don't want to be perceived as a nice guy who are not nice to children. I would like the schools to close and most teachers to be on the breadlines. I think they've done tremendous harm to kids, and I don't feel like being nice to them. They weren't nice to my kids. They weren't nice to other people's kids. And I would like them to, you know, in the end, reap what they sowed. I can be a terribly not nice guy, but I love my children, and I love children, and I love family, and I love families. And I think these things need to be assiduously supported. And I love the idea of what an education can do, open up the world to a child of possibilities from which they will select what they're going to pursue. That is worthy of an effort to
That's
me.
That's great. All right. Well, thank you so much for joining us again. It's been fun.
Yeah, you too.
Thank you for listening to The Luminous Mind. To learn more about Stephen Horwich, go to our show notes at theluminousmind.net. Be sure to become a subscriber to our free email list and consider joining our program by going to the scheduling tab to become a fire starter today. Help support the podcast by making all your Amazon purchases through the free Amazon widget on our website. Also, sign up to receive 2 free audiobooks from Audible at theluminousmind.net. Like us on Facebook, follow us on Twitter, Google+, and now Pinterest. Get our audio content by subscribing on YouTube, iTunes, and Stitcher. To help us grow, consider telling your friends about us. Leave us a review. Tell us how we can help you so together we can continue to light minds on fire and change the paradigm of education.